unto thee, O Lord. Do I lift up my soul unto thee, O Lord? Do I lift up my soul, O my God? I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not mine enemies triumph over me.
Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not mine enemies triumph.
Good evening. It's indeed a joy to come back on this Wednesday evening to start a new subject in our Bible study. Thank you for all your prayers. From now onwards, I will be leading the Bible study. Maybe we will study a book or something which will help the church to grow. This evening, my focus will be on the book of Acts, Acts of the Apostles. This season, we will be studying the book Acts of the Apostles, but my idea in studying this would be not to study the book verse by verse or chapter by chapter. We will dwell on the subject of seeing the vision of the church. What is God's vision for the church? God's vision, which he had even before the creation of the world, and how it was realized in the early church, and how the church is in this present scenario. We will do an analysis of these things so that we can get the correct understanding of the church that we belong to. Because church has been interpreted in many ways known to man. He has interpreted church in a way that he wants. But this effort in the Bible study from now on will be to see what is God's vision for the New Testament church. What is God's vision for the church? Before we dwell, let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Master, for this blessed evening. Thank you for enabling us to step into the new season of the Bible study, where, Lord, we are focusing on the book of the Acts of the Apostles to see what are those foundational truths for the church, what are those truths that can transform our understanding, transform our hearts and minds so that, Lord, we may become true worshippers in spirit and in truth. Loving Lord, as we move forward in this effort of studying the book, Lord, we pray that you give us the grace and mercy to understand, to live the living word in our lives. Master, it is not just the ritual here, it is individual efforts put on in discussion, in deliberation, and also, Lord, to learn together as a church so that we may be in your way, so that we can reach the specified destination for our lives, for our church, and for our fellowship as well. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Dear people of God, the one thing that I would like to lead us all is an Old Testament passage in which I saw a brief introduction of the vision of the church. I think it is the prophecy through Prophet Micah in chapter 4 that gives us the glimpse of what God is thinking with regard to the church in the New Testament. I read 3 verses from chapter 4, Micah chapter 4, verses from 1 to 3. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and it shall be lifted above the hills, and peoples shall flow to it, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many people and shall decide for strong nations far away, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all the peoples walk each in the name of its God, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. A wonderful passage in which we see the summary of what the church is in the heart of God, in the mind of God. What we see in this passage is that the house of the God of Jacob, that the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. Why it has to be established as the highest of the mountains? Because God intends that is, church become a center of instruction, a center of justice, a and the center of righteousness. Very crucial for us to understand this, because unless we understand why we are as a church, we may not contribute much towards the growth of the church. That is the sad part that is happening in the churches today. My dear people of God, the church that God intends is a church in which we see that it has been established as a center of instruction, as a center of the law of God, the word of God. And the second thing that we see is that it has to be the center in which it teaches its people about the justice of God. And the third thing that we see in this passage is that it will be a center of righteousness. Isn't it interesting? It is in the Old Testament. And we see that church has its own purpose. And the purpose is revealed here. And if you follow this purpose, what happens, we see in verse 3, verse 4, and verse 5. Verse 3 says that there will be transformation in the lives of the people. Transformation according to the instruction, according to the justice, according to the righteousness of God. And then comes the individual responsibility in verse 4. Because if we follow the goal that God has set for the church, then the person who belongs to the body of Christ, the church, will be with the Lord, and nobody will make him afraid. And then they will walk in the name of the God forever and ever. My dear people of God, just see this passage and see what happened in the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Yes, the church in Jerusalem became a center of instruction. It became a center of justice. It became a center of righteousness. You know, these apostles who believed in Jesus Christ became people and agents of transformation. And then what happened was they turned the world upside down. They were not afraid of anything, even the death. Isn't it that interesting? I will start with this passage, my dear people of God. I would allow you to go back and reflect on this passage, Micah 4, 1 to 5. And then with this in background, we will enter into the book of the Acts of the Apostles. A learning through the book of the Acts of the Apostles. As I said, we will not go verse by verse or chapter by chapter. It's a different approach altogether. We will see the concepts that has been established as foundational truths for the church. Because you belong to the church, I belong to the church. And if we do not understand what exactly is the church, then we may not be able to contribute much. See, for example, if you go to a university to learn something, you know why that university is being established, why that university is famous, why you are there as a student in that university, and then what you do is focus on the foundational truths of the university, and you contribute much in learning as well as in growth. My dear people of God, this is what we need. We need to go forth as well as grow up, individually, as a family, as a fellowship of Jesus Christ. Isn't it that the purpose of the book of the Acts of the Apostles? And that is what we will be focusing this evening. We will be dwelling upon this subject maybe for half an hour or 40 minutes, and then we will move forward in learning. If you have any questions, I will be very happy to answer it. Speak to me over the phone personally. You have my number there. You have my email. If you have any concerns or any questions, any points that you want me to understand, I will be very happy to receive those suggestions and also those points, and we will discuss together so that we may learn together. As I said, we will be dwelling on God's vision for the church. Are we in the vision or are we not in the vision of God? That is the question that we need to start with. Are we in the vision of God or are we not in the vision of God with regard to the church? This question must have a clear answer to each one of us who are part of the church. My dear people of God, churches has been interpreted in many different ways. You know, because some of the churches are dominated by the denominational doctrines. Some churches are famous for something else rather than what we see in the early church. Some churches think that they are better than the other churches. We have different interpretation of the church. What we are doing this evening in this season of this Bible study, as we dwell on the Acts of the Apostles, is to see what is the vision of God for His church in this world. As we started from the prophet of Micah, chapter 4, and we saw what are those things that God intends in His church and why it needs to be elevated to a different level. He says that it is the highest of all the mountains, meaning that it is on the top position or in a place where people come to see all the other things through that viewpoint. And that is where we belong to as a church. Now we need to understand whether we are in that vision of God or not. And then we need to move forward. Two things that should unite us this evening in truth and spirit. The first thing that we need to be united is that we are all committed to the church. At least I hope we all are. I hope that none of my fellowship, the Bible study fellowship students here tonight in the Bible study is an unchurched Christians, for the New Testament knows nothing as such a monster. My dear people of God, as I said, people have interpreted church in the ways they wanted. And one among those interpretations is that I don't have to belong to any church, but still I am the disciple of Jesus Christ. I don't have to belong to any fellowship, but still I can be Christian. My dear people of God, the New Testament speaks about that person as a monster. Because there is nothing as unchurched Christian in the New Testament. Are you part of a church or not, is the question. If not, then you need to think very seriously. Are you pursuing to be unchurched Christian throughout your life? Or will you be part of the church and be a disciple of Jesus Christ? The first thing. Because we are getting united in spirit and truth. And the truth about the church is, truth about the disciples is that the disciple must belong to a church, to a fellowship. We are not only committed to Jesus Christ, we are committed to the body of Jesus Christ. My dear people of God, the head of the body is Jesus Christ. And many of us just connect with Jesus Christ, but not with the fellowship. Both are different. The head of the church is Jesus Christ. Yes, He is a person. He is a Savior. He is a Messiah. He is God. One among the Trinity. But are we connected to the body of Christ? Another question that we need to answer, because there is nothing defined in the New Testament as unchurched Christian or unchurched Christian faith. My dear people of God, many of us do not attend the church. Many of us are not part of a fellowship, not part of a body of Christ. Can we be acceptable in the sight of God if we are unchurched Christian? No, my dear people of God. We need to come to the truth so that we can be liberated into that freedom. As I said in the book of Micah, in the latter days, what the people will do is that many people will be walking in the name of their gods, but we will be walking in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. It is not just in this world. It will move on from this world into another world in the future. So that is the reason we need to see that we are the people who follow Jesus Christ and also part of the body of Christ, the church. Indeed, we cannot be one without the other, for the church lies at the center of the purpose of God. God's purpose was conceived in the past eternity, being worked out in the history to be perfected in the future eternity. Three parts: conceived in the past eternity, being worked out in the history, that we see the beginning in the book of the Acts of the Apostles, and now it has been perfected into the future eternity. It's not just to save souls, but rather call out people for himself and build his church. My dear people of God, as we all know, that there is a vision, there is a purpose in the mind and heart of God. If you are not part of that mission of God, then what is the purpose of being in the church? That is a question that we need to answer. What is the part of being the called out people? What is the question of interpretations that give us some comfort as individuals, as or a denomination, or as a church? If we are really people of God, we need to see that it was conceived in the past eternity. It has been worked out in the history, and now we are on the mode of perfection for eternity. Not just calling people or saving souls, but rather call out a people for himself and build his church. My dear people of God, this is very crucial for us to understand, because we are speaking about something which is very, very important as a church. Since we do not know the vision of the church, since we do not know the purpose of the church, since we do not know the depth of why the church exists, we just are being religious. We just behave as if we are one among many with regard to faith and religion, and we do not have the seriousness of the church. We have observed in the church as pastors that many people come just to pray and offer prayers and then go back. They are not part of any activity of the church. Some people come after the church. Some people come during the church, during the week, and pray and then get out of the church. Will that be acceptable in the sight of God is a question that I and you need to answer. Can that be the normal behavior as the disciple of Jesus Christ? My dear people of God, we all need to think through it. God's purpose, as I said, was conceived in past eternity, even before the creation of the universe. In the mind of God, church was already established. What was established was worked out in the history for the past 2,000 years, beginning in the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Now, after it has been established as the body of Christ, it is being led into perfection for future eternity. My dear people of God, we will focus on this. Jesus died not only to redeem us from sin, but to purify for himself a people who are enthusiastic for good works. We have a responsibility. We have something to accomplish. It's not just coming on Sundays. It is not just becoming a Christian. God is looking for those people who can walk with him in his name forever and ever. Enthusiastic for good works. Isn't it that interesting? I said, church is a place of instruction. Church is a place of justice. Church is a place of righteousness. So if you are building your life in these things, what happens is that you will be passionate about the good works. Titus 2:14 speaks about this truth, and it says, he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. So twofold purpose is what the original purpose of God for each and every believer. It is a reflection. It should be a reflection for each one of us. My dear people of God, we are dwelling on the book of the Acts of the Apostles. We are dwelling on those concepts which has been revealed. What I'm exposing you to must be something which you will probe into the book of the Acts of the Apostle, whether to see what I'm telling is true or false. Because what you see in the Acts of the Apostles is the concepts of God's heart being realized. So, Titus 2:14 says, he might redeem us from every lawlessness and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. My dear people of God, that is what God is intending to do in the body of Christ. He is very passionate. Don't you see that passion in this verse? As we see Titus 2:14, he is very clear in his mind why he established the body of Christ. He wants to call out people who will stand for him according to his instruction, according to his justice, according to his righteousness. Are you part of that? Do you know what exactly God is speaking about the church? The question that we need to reflect upon this evening is, am I being liberated from the lawless life that I had? Or I am part of currently? Am I according to the instruction of God? The first question. The second thing is, am I leading myself into the purity through the power of the Holy Spirit? The third thing that we need to see, that am I a chosen race, a special people, zealous for the good work? Threefold purpose for each and every believer. My dear people of God, we need to reflect upon this. We are all committed to the church, isn't it? And this is the first part that we need to reflect upon. And the second part that we need to see is, we are all concerned for the renewal of the church, isn't it? In many parts of the world, the church is spreading rapidly. But it is often growth without depth. That is the sad part of the church. Yes, it is growing rapidly. It is being known by the people rapidly. People are coming to the faith. But when you see the depth of those churches, you do not find those depths. Can we lead our lives without the depth? Can you imagine an early church that is being described in the book of the Acts of the Apostles without depth? Can we afford to be church without the spiritual depth? The question to ponder upon. There is much superficiality everywhere. The superficiality of Christian faith is rampant everywhere. Will God accept that superficiality and give us the blessings that we are entitled as the body of Christ? My dear people of God, we need to think through it. We need to recover that biblical vision for the renewal of the church. Unless we are revived, we will be of no use. But if we are thinking of revival, then we need to see whether we are growing deep, whether our roots are growing deep and absorbing the nutrients that is needed for the fruits above from the sources of the living water, that is the Holy Spirit. Are we part of the superficiality of the church, or are we thinking about growing deeper? Because the church in Jerusalem in the first century was a church which was growing deep into the resources of God. Exactly the way Jesus behaved in the four Gospels, Peter and John behaves as they go to worship in the temple. Silver and gold I have none, but in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. See the audacity, see the depth that they had in the proclamation of the gospel. Why they had that? Because they believed that the name which saved them from lawlessness has given them the power to be part of the body of Christ. We need to recover the biblical vision of the renewed church. So today, the study will be to those who are committed to the church, to understand the concept of the church according to the purposes of God, and to grow deeper with God so that we may become the channels of blessing in the renewal of the church. My dear people of God, what we have seen this evening is two parts. One, we have gone to the Old Testament from the book of Micah, chapter 4, verses from 1 to 5. We studied that passage and saw what is the vision of the church. It has been revealed in a way that people could understand at that particular point of time. Now, the same has been realized in the book of Acts, Acts of the Apostles. And it became a place of instruction, a place of justice, a place of righteousness. Even today, that is the purpose of the church. And as we dwell on that particular part, we did understand that two truths which can liberate the church, which can liberate the church from what it is today into a renewed body of Christ. First, we saw that God conceived the idea of the church in past eternity. It was worked out in the history. And then God is working to perfect the church to future eternity. So as he is doing that, he is intending the people who belong to the body of Christ to liberate themselves from the lawlessness. And then they become people who are passionate about being holy in their lives. so that holiness will lead them into action for the good works. Titus 2:14. And then when we came to the second part, we saw that if we are intending to be part of the renewal of the church, we need to see how deep we are going day by day as a church. We need to overcome the superficiality of the church and then grow deeper to the resources of the living water. Hope this helped you to understand what is the vision of the church. We will move forward in the coming weeks to see how best we can understand. Think through it, deliberate on this. The homework for today will be the readings from the prophet Micah 4:1-5 and also Titus 2:14. Read this, meditate upon this and see what God is speaking to you. And see how best you can contribute yourself to the church, to the body of Christ. And I also urge you to read one chapter every day until this season ends. As you read the Acts of the Apostles and see what is happening there, what God has spoken in the Old Testament, what He has done in the Acts of the Apostles, and what He is intending to do currently with us. I think the combination of these three things will help us to learn more and more every week. Hope you enjoyed this. I like to listen to your comments. I love to listen to your discussion points. Keep yourself engaged. Engage with the scriptures so that you can learn and deliberate and think through, because as we deliberate on things, on the living word, what happens is God reveals to each and every one of us in a way that we can understand, and so that can become a contribution to the fellowship, contribution to the learning, so that we all can learn and stand strong as a church. My dear people of God, may God continue to bless us and use us. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Master, for leading us and guiding us this week. Thank you, Master, for leading us into this blessed book, the Acts of the Apostles. Lord, even as we are dwelling on the concepts, on the visions that you have revealed and that you have been working with in the book, Lord, give us the grace to understand this so that we may have the clarity of why we are part of the body of Christ, and so that we may grow deeper and bear fruits for your glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Oh.